happening. So my first, the question is, should human elephant conflict management be based on science, which I think it should, or should it be based on socio-political demands, which is how it is being managed today? If you take the situation in Sri Lanka, Sri Lanka has around 6,000 elephants in the wild. While Sri Lanka doesn't have the highest number of Asian elephants among the 13 Asian elephant range states, it has the highest density of Asian elephants. Sri Lanka also has a very high human population density of over 300 persons per square kilometer. And we are an island with a limited land area and limited natural resources with an expanding human population. That is why Sri Lanka has the highest incidence of human elephant conflict in the world, not only among Asian elephant range states, but even among the African elephant range states. Just looking back historically, there were elephants in Sri Lanka almost scattered almost throughout the entire country. Then during the colonial period, the elephants in the red zone were basically eliminated for development. And the elephants were concentrated largely in the dry zone as it is today, except for two spots in the wet zone, Singharaja, and the peak wilderness has a very small population of elephants. Then in the 1950s, 60s and 70s, the governments, successive governments of Sri Lanka came up with large-scale irrigation projects to try to develop agriculture. And we selected areas where there are elephants. These areas marked in red are some of the large-scale agriculture irrigation development projects that were initiated by the government. To compensate for that, we came up with a network of protected areas, hoping that the wildlife can be put into the protected areas. Those are the areas that I have identified in green. With development of reservoirs, we had large-scale reservoirs opening out in the dry zone and large tracts of agricultural land. And from the 1950s, in fact in 1959, there was a decision made that when development takes place, herds of elephants can be driven through temporary corridors connecting those green areas that I showed as protected areas and fenced in so that development can take place. At that time when we did this, we didn't have any information to make this decision. We went on what we felt was the best available information. Since then, a lot more information has been found on how this could be or should be done. So basically what we are trying to do is identify an area like the one in red for development, and then we identify an area like in green where we have a protected area, and our objective is to try to move the elephants out of the red area, the development areas, into the protected area. The time we were doing this, we had no concept of carrying capacity. And by carrying capacity, I mean, can this green area support that many elephants? Because for elephants to survive, there has to be food and water. Is there adequate food and water in these green areas to do this strategy? That was not looked at. So since the 1950s, we have taken, Sri Lanka has taken three approaches to human-elephant conflict management. The first one is translocation of problem elephants to department, DWC's Department of Wildlife Conservation Protected Areas. Basically, if there is an elephant who is damaging crops, killing or harming people, or damaging property, we capture that elephant and translocate him into a wildlife department protected area to get rid of the problem. Then in areas that we have identified, if we have identified large areas for development, we do what we call large-scale elephant drives. From the red area, you drive all these elephants into the green areas. The red area is open out for development. And once we drive these elephants into protected areas, the strategy is to confine these elephants into the Department of Wildlife protected areas with the help of physical, biological and psychological barriers. Now, all three approaches attempted to confine elephants only to Department of Wildlife Conservation protected areas. Somebody forgot to tell the elephants that the administrative boundary of wildlife, you are not supposed to cross that. Right? Elephants travel on ecological boundaries. They don't understand administrative boundaries like you and me. Then this strategy has been adopted for the last 50 years. Has this strategy worked? If so, shouldn't we see a declining in the human-elephant conflict? Because wildlife department protected areas don't have humans. So if there are no humans, you can't have a human-elephant conflict. But about 3 or 4 years ago, we did an elephant distribution survey in Sri Lanka. All the areas in red have no elephants, only humans. So obviously there is no conflict there. The areas in green are wildlife department protected areas. There are elephants and no humans. So no conflict there as well. But the areas in yellow, which is 44% of the country, there are humans and elephants sharing the same landscape, and that's where we have the conflict. And if you look at the HEC statistics, it shows from 2000 to 2017, the number of elephant deaths and the number of human deaths have been increasing. So obviously the 50-year strategy that we adopted in Sri Lanka has failed. I also would like to put the human-elephant conflict into perspective. If you look at the number of human deaths, human fatalities due to traffic accidents, buses, motorcycles, three-wheelers and elephants. Elephants are almost negligible compared to the other. So, while we have huge demonstrations by villagers saying that elephants should be driven out of their areas, elephants should not be permitted to be there, elephants are the cause of death, do we have any protests saying that there shouldn't be vehicles driving on the roads because of deaths? 70% of the human male deaths are due to human irresponsibility. Most of them are drunk at night, walking around in landscapes that you share with elephants. And they come across elephants, you're dead drunk, you see an elephant, you challenge the elephant, and you get yourself killed. There are instances where people ride bicycles into elephants. They don't even know that there was an elephant on the road until they hit the elephant, and the elephant reacts. So, many of our deaths can be avoided if we human beings take a little more responsibility for our lives. The indigenous community and areas that there are Purana governments, ancient villages, they don't have much of a conflict with elephants because they know how to coexist with elephants. It is the villages that were resettled into the dry zone as a result of all these irrigation projects who don't really know how to coexist with elephants or think that they can do what they want to do at whatever time they want to do, that they run into elephants and have problems. I am not saying that there are no elephants who attack people. But generally, I am a person who studies elephant behavior. Elephants are very risk averse. They don't like to get into confrontation even among themselves. The human-elephant conflict is because they are reacting to our actions. Now let's look at some of the measures that we have taken to try to deal with the problem. Now this is a garbage dump outside Hambantota where there were elephants coming. And the previous government wanted the elephants relocated. So when they were captured and translocated, we managed to convince the wildlife department, this was before I joined the wildlife department, we managed to convince the wildlife department, put a few radio collars on some of these elephants so that we can figure out once we translocate them what happens to them. So this elephant was now captured, tranquilized, collared. Now he's been taken from Hambantota where that little truck is where the garbage dump. The yellow line is the electric fence of Yala National Park. And northeast of that is Yala National Park. So he was taken by truck all the way into Yala National Park, beyond Manikganga into Block 2, and he was released. Now one would think that once you take an elephant and put him in a national park, he should be very happy there. He wouldn't come out. But elephants have very high fidelity to their home range, where they range. The next day, he started coming back. He was not ranging aimlessly looking for where to come. He knew exactly, because we get these data points every 4 hours. So he knew exactly where to come. Till he came and bumped into the electric fence. So for about a day he was walking around the fence trying to figure out how to get through it. Then he got through it. 48 hours later, he was back in the garbage dump with his radio collar and all. elephants to get an idea whether translocations work. And 17 elephants were radio collared, translocated elephants. They were captured from development areas and then released. All 17 were released in different wildlife department protected areas. Every single one of them left the wildlife department protected area. Three came back to the location that they were captured. 14 left the wildlife department protected area and went into an adjacent forest department protected area. Now, of the 14 that went into forest department land, 12 went into a new development area surrounding that forest department. So basically what we did, we captured the problem elephant, translocated the elephant, and translocated the problem. Because he was creating a problem in one area, now this elephant is creating a problem in a new area. And in the new area, he doesn't know the area well. So he's creating problems in a larger area than he was doing before. And that resulted in 5 elephants being killed, shot dead by farmers, and 5 human beings also were killed. So, it clearly shows that when you capture and translocate an elephant into a new location, they want to go back to where they were. When they don't know how to go back, only they start roaming elsewhere. They leave wildlife department areas and go into forest department areas for a particular reason. We all think elephants like thick forest. Elephants do not actually like thick forest. The ideal elephant habitat is degraded forest. So forest department land has more chena, illegal chena agriculture not taking place. The forest is degraded, so they tend to go there rather than remain in wildlife department land. So this clearly showed us that capture translocations is not a viable alternative to manage the human elephant conflict. So that is a serious problem. So capture translocations don't work. Now let's look at large-scale elephant rides. And the area identified in brown at the bottom, that is the Valavelefkan development area. Right? There are elephants in this whole area. And we move elephants from this whole shaded area in red, so that we can do more development. So an elephant drive was conducted, and elephants were driven into Lumbumba Mehra National Park. And we saw mostly females and calves being driven, very few males were being driven. Right? And that drive is so stressful to the females and the calves, and the females are your breeding population, that affects the breeding population. So it has huge conservation implications, and it has no benefit to the humans. They were trying to go back to where they came from. So they were close to the electric fence. So they destroyed the vegetation because there were 200 odd elephants suddenly in this very small area. They were eating everything that was inside. And obviously they are running out of food. The first 2 years of life, the elephant, baby elephant depends a lot on the mother's milk. The mother doesn't have enough nutrition to generate the amount of milk that she needs. 54% of the elephants in baby elephants in Yala are dying. That is why you don't see elephants in Yala now. Then we started observing the elephants' body condition deteriorated. They were getting thinner, bones were being shown, spine were being shown, ribs were being shown. That means they don't have enough food inside the national park. And then the elephants started dying of starvation inside the national park. The electric fence is to protect people from elephants. Why don't you fence the people in? Why don't you put fences around the village? Why don't you put fences around agriculture? Because that, if a fence is going behind my house, I'm not going to sit and twiddle my thumbs waiting for wildlife department to come and fix the fence. I will fix it, because if not, my house will get attacked. So you can use communities to do management of the fence, because that is the biggest shortcoming in fences. Now, if you take Yala National Park, the red line is the current fence. So rather than putting the fence in the red line, we are saying put it in the buffer zone. Right? The green part is forest department scrubland. The brown part is chena. The ecological boundary is this. So we were suggesting that you put the fence on the ecological boundary. After that, it's a village. Elephants have no business to be in the village. But the green part and the brown part are protected areas of the forest department. So if you allow the elephants to roam in that area, you can have the fences on the ecological boundary, give more land for the elephants. In areas that there are no contiguous forests, community-based village fences, we have tried pilots of this in the Weimar province, and it's working very successfully with the community involved. Then we have community-based seasonal agricultural fences on the periphery of paddy fields. Understanding with the farm organization that once the crop is harvested, the fence is taken down, allowing elephants to come and eat the crop residue. Because the farmer doesn't eat the crop residue, the elephants can come and eat it. During that 2 to 3 week period, sightings of elephants on that land is almost guaranteed. If we can figure out a way of getting tourists to come and see elephants there and pay the farm organizers, not the hotel, you suddenly make the elephant an economic asset to the local community, not an economic liability. Then the people will be more willing to coexist. So, we should look for sustainable institutional mechanisms to maintain fences, but we can always figure out ways of converting the elephant into an economic asset. Tourism can be done, community-based tourism. In other countries they do it, in Nepal they do it, in Bhutan they do it, community-based tourism. Right? You can have watch huts like this near waterholes. Let tourists go there for the community to get some money from it, because they will make very much more than the money they are making from agriculture today. So if we start taking that type of approach, we can come up with a win-win situation. If not, what would happen is the children and grandchildren won't be able to see sites like this. And I'm not trying to promote elephants over humans. I'm trying to come up with an arrangement where coexistence is possible between elephants and humans, and rural communities do benefit from it. I would like to end by saying that this presentation was prepared in collaboration with the Center for Conservation and Research, because some of the scientific data was from them. And I hope that I have kindled a passion in you that we should all get together and try to save the elephants of this country. Thank you very much.